Good evening and welcome to a new edition of To The Point. Before we start, we'd like to pay our deep condolences to the families of those innocent lives that have been martyred in the tragic incident, the terrorist incident, which took place in Egypt a couple of days ago. Sometimes you reach a stage where you feel you're really lost for words, for a very simple reason, because not that it can be condoned or even accepted, but if you're a soldier standing in the battlefield, and unfortunately we have soldiers standing, be it from the armed forces or the police, standing in the terrorist battlefield, so to speak, and those innocent lives that are wasted in tragic incidents like that, well, it's expected because he is in a battlefield. But to have people being killed for praying, atrocity of the action itself is really not something, it's really quite mind-boggling, and for most of us Egyptians, it's quite shocking that terrorism has reached this stage where it is not respecting religion under the alleged pretext of religion. Innocent people praying in a church, and someone walks in and detonates himself right there in the house of God, thinking that this is somehow called on upon by whatever religion he belongs to. Because I don't think that any heavenly religion actually accepts, prohibits, or propagates such atrocious acts, such murderous acts. Egypt has been calling for a confrontation and a unified stance by the world at large to confront terrorism. What's happening here, or what happened in Egypt, either Friday or Sunday, and the wasted innocent lives that have been wasted, is not only restricted to Egypt. It is touching the world at large. We've been calling for unified action to stand against those who house, harbor, and even provide a safe haven for terrorism. Somehow, it is falling on deaf ears. And the question is, why? In whose interest is it to support and fund and condone organizations such as the Brotherhood, such as the Jabhat al-Nusra, such as Al-Qaeda, such as Daesh, or whatever name, which are all different faces to the same coin? When will the world start to take action, impose sanctions against countries that provide a safe haven to those organizations, that fund those organizations, that provide armament to those organizations, and even training to those people? When? When are we going to stand and realize that this danger is not only engulfing us here in this part of the world, in the Middle East or Africa, but it is destroying the minds of the future? Because when a 22-year-old, or whatever his age is, walks into a church and detonates himself, killing innocent lives, 24 have been killed, 48 are injured. And mind you, let us pray that the 48 survive, because they're in serious critical condition. Somehow, if your legs are chopped or amputated, maybe you would wish you wouldn't live. Some of those cases are in that grave danger, that will have some kind of a disability that they will carry throughout life. Why? Because we're leaving some terrorist organizations to brainwash the future of this world, our future generation, our children. If this attempt is to destroy the fabric, or to rip apart the fabric of the Egyptian society, mind you, it's not working. More than ever, Egyptians will stand united. Egyptian Copts will pray, and Muslims will stand outside their church and protect them. Muslims will pray, and Egyptian Copts will stand outside the mosques and protect them. If there is no church, and if there are no mosques, we'll pray in the street. Egyptians have always unified under one flag. Sunnis fighting Shiites and whatever, this religious strife will never materialize and work in Egypt. We have always coexisted as Egyptians, regardless of our faith, and we will continue to coexist this way. For those who are funding and hoping that they can counter the two revolutions and impose a certain fascist terrorist organization reinstated back in Egypt, it will not happen. This country will not be divided. This country will be even stronger. A country that is mentioned in all the holy books, literally speaking, in all holy books, it is protected by God, and it will continue to be protected by its people. More importantly is, how can we save the future generations? This evening with us, we have a distinguished panel. With us this evening is Dr. Mouneer Hanna Youssef, who is the Archbishop of the Episcopal and the Anglican Church here in Egypt, North Africa, and the Middle East. A pleasure to have you with us. With us also this evening is Dr. Mohamed Abu Leila, Professor of Islamic Studies in English in Al-Azhar University. A pleasure to have you with us. And before we take a short break to look at some kind of a documentary or a report, maybe I'd like to extend my deep condolences to both Archbishop Anis and Dr. Abu Leila for the tragic incident in which a lot of innocent lives were wasted here in Egypt, be it in the tragic incident on Friday or in the even more tragic incident on Sunday. We'll be right back in a few moments, so please stay with us.
قدر كنيستنا المصرية أن تقدم شهداء.
والمصاب ده مش مصابكم أنتوا بس، ده مصابنا كلنا، إحنا حاجة واحدة. دي ضربة إحباط.
نتألم كثيرا لهذا الشر الذي تخلى عن كل إنسانية. الذي يفعل هذا لا ينتمي لمصر على الإطلاق حتى وإن كان على أرضها.
لازم حننتصر لأن إحنا أهل خير مش أهل شر.
لا تحسب أنك حققت شيئا.
مش هسيب طارنا حتى بعد اللي قبضنا عليه.
يحفظ الله وحدتنا الوطنية على أرض مصر.
أعزائي الشعب مصر كله، الضربة دي وجعتنا، لكن أبدا الضربة دي عمرها ما هتكسرنا.
Welcome back. Gentlemen, maybe I'll start the discussion with how can a 22-year-old be brainwashed to the extent that he can walk into a church, a house of God, strapped with 12 kilos of explosives, kill himself and others? How can someone be brainwashed into actually killing himself, killing his future? How can this happen?
I think it is a journey. It's a way, it's a big road since childhood for this young man. Starting with the education. Education that is not perfect, not good, not prepare him to accept others and to accept differences. Education that does not help in having religious harmony in the curricula and all these things. Then it comes to the house itself, his own family, maybe. The family is not tied, probably, or dysfunctional family. And then what he learned through the mosque and also the people who he mixed with to listen to religious opinions. Mm. All these factors shape the mind of a boy like this. It's not just for 1 year or half or 2 years or so. It's a long journey to shape a mind of a boy in this way. So if we are to think and reflect, we have to reflect on this journey and see where we should tackle and how we should tackle all these weak points in the journey of our young people.
Dr. Abu Leila, I'm sorry, but I will diversify maybe the question, and that is for the sake of those who are watching, especially for non-Egyptians. Is this action in any format condoned in Islam?
Utterly and definitely. Definitely, this is an irreligious act. And such a boy was misinformed, miseducated, and he was living in a fanatic environment. And we have to blame ourselves too, as teachers, as professors, as leaders of the church, as shiuch in al-Azhar. We have to stop and question how it comes, how is that such a boy? And I can't actually, it is horrible, horrifying when I concentrate on the scene. I expect anything to attack except the house of worship. This is a very bad sign to enter inside the church and to kill innocent people, not only innocent, but worshippers.
They stand, people praying.
Stand before God, asking him to save the life of everyone, and all of a sudden they lost their own life. It is horrible, and actually I don't express my condolence to anyone as a person. When my father died, my mother died, or my sister, or my beloved neighbor, it is me to receive condolence, not to express it. This is the case with me. Children, women, young, old people who are innocent and unarmed, only with iman, with faith. They were well armed with faith in God. They left their home to come this day to worship God in St. Peter's church in the hope to go back to their go back home. In this case, actually, a colleague of my own daughter, who is a doctor, was lost in this church. My daughter is badly sad. We are very sad. We are, as Egyptian, in one voice, we condemn. Now, I don't like to talk about religion, about Islam, forbidding these acts. It is a well-known fact. But I'm talking about our emotion, about our stand, to what extent we shall continue like that. No heaven in Egypt. Can we dare to ask? No place is saved? No. The whole world should be united to stop these things. Dur al-ibadah, Allah himself says in the Quran, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بَبَعْضٍ. Had Allah not protect one nation or a set of people by means of another, there would have been destroyed churches, synagogues, and mosques in which Allah is praised. All of them, not only in the masjid. They praise Allah their own way. We praise Allah our own way. Allahu nur samawati wal ard. Let the light of Allah be into these houses of worship, in which there are many people worshipping Allah and chanting his name. This is in two surahs in the Quran. So fi buyutin adhin Allah, in houses that Allah permitted to be raised in honor to Allah the Almighty. So it is very sad.
Unfortunately, this has nothing to do with religion.
Nothing.
The boy that went in and detonated himself, he was brainwashed, thinking that if you kill your, he's not killing himself, but he's really offering himself to God, and in return he will be rewarded, he will go to heaven, and all those material heavenly things that he has been promised, he will be fulfilled with if he carries out this act.
You excuse me, Tina, again, sorry to come again to the same point, but I'd like to say, to emphasize that I have one sacred book of which I believe. This is the Quran. I have a belief in the Torah, in the Gospel. Next to this is the, or before this, is the human soul. Human blood is a sacred. Anyone violates this is not neither Muslim, nor Christian, nor Jewish.
As I was saying, even though supposedly it's done under a religious pretext, in reality it is not. Definitely. This is all a political game. Recently we just heard some kind of announcement, and we have no news to confirm or deny this issue, that Daesh has claimed responsibility for this act. And I'm saying we have so far no confirmation of this.
Yes.
But should it be Daesh or the Brotherhood or whatever it is, at the end of the day, this is all political. How can we unpoliticize religion? Because unfortunately we have mixed the two, and the young generations are being wasted in the process. How can we change this concept?
I think it's not just purely political, because people who do these acts, they believe deep in their hearts that they are serving God.
Yeah, they're brainwashed enough to be convinced that they're not committing suicide.
And this is from the first century, when Christianity started. Saul, who became Apostle Paul afterward, he was killing Christians, dragging them on the roads and killing them, taking them into prisons, thinking that he is presenting and serving God. That's his mentality. He was also a kind of a terrorist. That was back in the first century. When the church, before the Reformation happened, killed people and burned people on the stake because they translate the Bible from the Latin language into the English language, they were thinking that they are serving God. So I think there is a religious, strong religious motive behind all these acts. Of course, the people who manipulate these people are politicians.
Who are funding the whole, the 12 kilos of explosives cost money.
Yes, but this requires from us to do a kind of a reformation for the way of thinking, like what happened back in the Middle Ages in the church. Because we used to have the same things like Daesh.
How can you change the mentality? How can you do this right now? When the problem is that it's not, in the Middle Ages, you did not have all the social media manipulating.
Yes.
Now, our children, as we talk, have a computer on their mobiles.
I think the most important thing is to allow self-criticism and to allow reformation to encourage reformation from inside. Because before reformation, at the Middle Ages, the church rejected any kind of self-criticism. You cannot criticize the Pope. Even if he did something wrong, he's infallible. And if you spoke against the Pope, you will be burned, or you will be punished, you will be excommunicated. But allowing self-criticism and allowing reformation to happen within the religion changes this atmosphere completely. But we, as Christians, went through all this before. And I think we need to learn from history. In order to combat this kind of extreme thinking. But again, we need to see where are our weak points. Education.
Definitely, this is the start.
This is the start.
Dr. Mohamed.
Yes, I think the renewal of religious discourse is a must. And by this, I don't mean that to condemn what we have now, or
it's not enough,
or to give a lead to someone to jump and attack. No, I am a scholar of Al-Azhar, but I am saying it myself. Renewal of the religious discourse must be done. We must have a rationalized discourse, which takes everything around us into consideration when we talk about people, other people, or about our people. We have to check our curriculum, our way of educating, not only our education, not only our curriculum or the methodology how to teach. There are a segment, or there are many, many people who escape the learning in schools. They are illiterate and they are liable and vulnerable to anyone who can play with their minds. We have to have a safe environment to give, instead of to say self-criticism, self-respect. We put together self-respect with self-criticism. And because we have no infallibility now, we don't have, whether in Christian part or in Islam, we never have an infallibility. Any man can be criticized, any man can be talked about it, but providing that, we talk not just for the sake of aggressiveness, just to be aggressive or rude to someone, but to search for truth, or to search for something more practical and more beneficial. So if we look at our children in their flowery age and educate them and revive their conscience as time goes, I think much of what we see will not have any place. Especially nowadays, we have a lot of challenges. We have a lot of needs, urges, which left its impact on all of us, especially the weak parts in the society.
Yes.
We have to look at this point very, very carefully. And we should help people to gain a good personality. Because once I gain a good personality, no one can mislead me. No one can take me his way. I will be self-critic, and I can argue, and I can consider what I hear. And there is no end. There is no absolute authority that anyone can claim. The absolute authority with Allah, and in our sacred books, after that, no absolute authority, no infallibility. We should exchange views, advices, and help each other to understand the life, and to understand that we all go back to one origin. كلكم لآدم. All of you come from Adam, and Adam was created from dust. All of us. We are not belonging to animals, different animals. We are belonging to one human.
But
only.
If, when we talk about education, I'm sorry, but I have to go back to one thing, and that is the concept of fanaticism, really, that way. We have only seen it recently. This division. I mean, we've always coexisted peacefully. We never really questioned one another's religion. I mean, this was not a topic. It was not an issue.
Until the 70s.
But we've had the same curriculum, really. If you think about it, we've had the same curriculum. Why is it that all of a sudden, We see, especially in the young generations, people are talking, I'm a Muslim, you're a Christian, you're a Jew, and I'm a Sunni, and you're a Shiite. I mean, even between Muslims.
It is politics.
So when we talk about education, what do we need? Is it curriculum reform? Or yes. Is it a reform of those who are even teaching the people?
Yes, this is more important. The teachers comes before the students. Mm. We should concentrate on this as well, on the teachers. Mm. What to say, what not to say. And this is very, very good question you raised, intentionally or unintentionally. So it is very good. We concentrate on the teachers who form and reform the brain of the national brain of our community. Mm. And I can't hear, I repeat, I am proud of being of Al-Azhar. Al-Azhar, some people say that Al-Azhar is teaching this and that. I was graduated.
But you're talking about Al-Azhar, you're talking about people that have finished school.
Yes.
The graduates, so to speak.
Because
we're talking about the young generation.
The young generation can belong to the education ministry, education and learning. And
or,
can
belong,
or Al-Azhar. That's
yes.
why I'm putting Al-Azhar in this. Mm. You see, I was graduated from Al-Azhar, Sheikh Abdul Halim Mahmoud, the Grand Imam. And we are very...
It's a different generation.
We have no.
It's a different, but that's what I'm saying. In the past, we didn't have this problem.
Yes.
Now we have it.
Yes. Search for why.
Is it the problem? Do you think those who, the teachers that teach Muslim studies or Christian studies in school, do you think we've reached a stage where unfortunately they're not spreading or teaching our children to be moderate and tolerant?
Moderate, tolerant.
Absolutely right. Mm-hmm. There is no curricula that really emphasizes accepting the differences and promoting religious harmony. We need this. Why we need this now? All the years before the 1970s, it was the same. Why we need this now? Because now these young people and children, and they hear from other sources, from the social media, from other teachers, things and teaching that contradict what
the core of religions.
The core of religion. And we should not actually invent a wheel. We should look at experiences of other states and other countries. One of the most important countries that really combated this religious differences and promoting religious harmony is Singapore. Mm. Singapore in the 60s, they were divided by sectarianism. And they knew that being a small country, if sectarianism happened, they will be lost completely. Economically, they will be lost. So they decided that the first 9 years of education, they need to put as much as they can that promote religious harmony and accept differences within the society. And they came and said to the religious groups, if you want to add on top of these 9 years, you are very welcome. Mm. If you want to add Islamic teaching, if you add Christian teaching, Buddhist teaching, Hindu teaching, you do it on top of these 9 years. But these 9 years of education, which is the core teaching until mid schools, are unified in all schools, whether private or public or Christian or Islamic, they are all the same. So the whole generation see things differently. They succeeded. And now they are one of the best countries that really enjoy religious harmony.
Mm. I think Archbishop, sectarianism, exclusiveness, racism, all are human sicknesses.
Yes.
Religion has nothing to do with this at all.
Mm.
And I can't see or foresee any contradiction between getting the Muslim very firm and strong in his religion, and the Christian too, firm and strong in his religion, providing that we bring out the elements that unite us unite and bring us together, hearts and shoulder by shoulder, two shoulders.
Can I ask you, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but right. Something just crossed my mind as you were talking, especially when you said the elements that bring us together. In our schools, how do we teach religion? The Muslims go to a class with their teacher. The Christians go to another class with their teacher. Fine. I don't expect Muslims to sit and Christians to memorize the Quran or the Muslims to memorize verses from
there
the Bible. This is understandable. Yes. But at the same time, where do Muslims and Christians unite to talk about religion? In other words,
yes, that's right.
The way we teach our kids, and this just came to my mind right now, and I personally have kids, and this is, and I was in school, so this is the vision that came to my mind, that dividing us in religious classes and not uniting us in any sort of class discussing religion, generally speaking, is in a way bringing up kids with this difference.
I can answer you briefly that someone in England long time ago, about 20 years ago, suggested that to teach our children all religions at once and delete our the child use which religion he goes. This will make
this is not what I'm saying.
Lost.
No, this is not what I'm saying. Yes, I'm saying that you have a class for Islam, you have a class for Christianity, and you have another class that talks about the essence of religions and how the commonality.
Yes,
it's one God, by the way.
Let's have a class to talk about
one God.
Archbishop, I said what I said now is in the context of what you said, but not exactly. A reproduction of it.
I understand, but I'm saying not saying.
Yes, we don't like to divide. We don't like to mix it with the point that every religion disappears.
No. When you don't teach Islam on its own, or Christianity, or Judaism on its own, then you mix. Don't teach them. I'm saying, how do we bridge in school? Kindergarten.
Yes. What is common between Islam and Christianity, for example, and Judaism? We can have a sort of book common, and we can bring Christianity.
This is what I mean, a class like that.
And each one study his own religion, but there is a commonality.
This is what I'm saying. Yes. I don't know. I'm not an expert.
No place or time or periods in the school that bring children together, Christian and Muslims, to discuss common values.
No, there isn't.
Or to learn about the other. What is the problem of a Christian boy learning about Islam? That's very important. And the vice versa as well. We have an excellent experiment that we did for 1 year with Al-Azhar, actually. It's called Planting a Tree of Hope. It's a project. We brought the young students, primary school, and we allowed them to visit Christian and Muslim places together, work together in art and culture together with the common values. For 1 year, we prepared Al-Azhar and the church, prepared the teachers to begin with. Then the teachers led the students into these different activities for over a year. At the end of the year, the children came and told us what you can expect, that it is music in your ear. That was wonderful. But we needed to repeat this and do this experiment several times.
We invest a lot of time learning history about different parts of the world.
Yes.
We teach our kids about
religion.
You teach your kids about Europe, about the United States, about Asia, about different parts of the world, different economies of the world, different languages of the world. We cannot invest the time to teach them about the different religions and maybe to find the common ground whereby they feel that we're not different, really.
We can do it if we are serious enough to do this and dig deep about it. We can do it in summertime.
What happened in the church, the tragic terrorist incident, is really, maybe it has nothing to do with what we're really talking about right now, except maybe this young boy who was turned into a terrorist due to the lack of proper education and knowledge and understanding of what even his own religion is supposed to be about. But it takes us to the fact that maybe we should capitalize on this and rethink the way we're going, where we are heading. Who do you think should initiate something like this? For example, we have this Beit al-Ila or this family. I mean, those institutions, we have Al-Azhar, we have the Coptic Church, the Anglican Church. I mean, we have, Egypt is really a cradle to a lot of religions. Yes. How can we convert, who should be leading this initiative, that this cradle is transferred to the minds of the young people? And maybe they can teach their parents.
Yes, Beit al-Ila is a wonderful
forum.
Forum to start this. And they already are working on curricula and presenting to the Ministry of Education some proposals about this, already doing this. But it's very slow and not quick, but I think it is, it's very important also to any difficult thought that is propagating in the society. For example, recently, not far away, people saying, don't say Happy Easter to a Christian. Yes, we hear this all the time. Don't say Happy Easter. We need Muslim scholars to stand up and say, no, we have to say Happy Easter, Merry Christmas to our people who are part of the society.
So isn't this something in schools? Because shouldn't schools, for example, in Easter have this Easter egg, in Christmas have the Christmas tree, in Ramadan have the lantern, and the Mouldin Nabi. I mean, the Prophet's birthday was on Sunday, and this day it was ruined for all of us. I mean, Muslims, Egyptian Muslims, did not celebrate because the whole day was turned into one big funeral. I have a lot of Christian friends that did not eat the traditional sweets, which we all went out and bought this year. I mean, it's a matter of how can we convert the minds, and how can we get, because this is not only an Egyptian thing, but how can we protect ourselves against those terrorist movements that have surfaced in this region? Yes.
Let's have a sort of national enterprise or national program, which can all of us share. Al-Azhar, the church, all organizations without exception, all schools without exception, each one take part of the of this national program. How it can bring some Christians, some Muslims, teach them in a sort of forum, in a sort of
Can this initiative be launched between Al-Azhar and the church? I mean, wait for the government has a lot the government fight the security issue, the economic problem.
I don't like to put it in the neck of the government, Al-Azhar and the church.
It's not politics here.
Yes. But it should be credited, and it should be supported by the state. Supported by the state as a national enterprise. All of us share. Everyone do something toward this. And this will help us with the long run, in the long run, to merge out of this dilemma.
As I said initially, this attempt is basically an attempt to rip the fabric of the Egyptian society. In the past, the scenario of killing Muslims or killing Christians and blaming the Muslims for doing it or Christians for doing that, this has been carried out a lot. And basically, it's because we tend to be a religious society. Everybody is quite possessive and protective and passionate about his religion. And I wouldn't accept someone killing someone in a mosque, nor would a Christian accept someone killing someone in a church, nor would a national Egyptian would accept the killings in either a mosque or a church. But the issue is that, unfortunately, this incident and... we do a very bad job as media. Sometimes we go after the news to the extent that we do not, and I'm part of that. And unfortunately, sometimes we become a bit inhuman, because some of the footage that has been carried out and printed, especially footage related to some of the victims of the church, people there. I mean, I don't think any religion I don't know, even know how to say it in English, because there is hurmat al-mayit, which I don't know, maybe you can translate what that is, because we learned it that way, and that is a dead person is quite sacred, and really he should be covered and protected from people's eyes. Unfortunately, the media displayed the footage because, you know, it's newsy. This footage hurt a lot of us. It especially the young generations, it's really quite painful, the families. I won't say how can we erase, but there is a lot of anger.
Actually, yes, Dina, sorry to cut off to the same point you are raising. I think why the attack come to the church here or inside in Upper Egypt or here, there, it is repeatable. It is not just for one time, because it is a sensitive and inflammable area. And if I allow myself and press on my conscience to accept it, if we compared the lost 25 or 4 victims to the number of Copts in Egypt, it looks too much. But I will not understand it like that. I'm comparing them to the 9 millions of Egyptian people. So
92.
I'm backward. 92 millions. They are part of 92 millions, not of a small community, or as the Western people say,
Because we have 2 minutes left, and I will give a message. I just want you to give a message, if I can start with the Archbishop, to give a message to, we have a lot of angry people. When you're angry, you can say a lot of things. You can do a lot of things. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, this passion, this anger has to be used in a constructive way, not in a destructive way. Mm-hmm. We have to understand that this whole issue has been orchestrated to divide us. What message would you send to Egyptians?
We reached a time of action now. The government, all the organizations like Al-Azhar, the church, we need to put things in action now. People who feel that they are discriminated or the law is not applied in certain cases, these need to be done and be very clear, because many, many of the incidents that happened in the past, the law was not applied. All just reconciliatory sessions, and whoever did wrong, he went...
Well, this is what the president is saying, that he wanted the parliament and the government to...
It's a time of action.
To reform.
People need to be appointed to high positions according to their qualification, not according to their religion. So I think if the government started to do this, the people in the street will learn a lesson. And I think if there is an action, there will be something different. Not just emotions. Yes, everyone is angry. Everyone is sad. My Muslim friends are more sad than us. to be honest. But it's time for action now.
Yes, I am appealing to any angry person. Please be wise in your anger, because anger is destruction, can destroy you and many beside you. And our problems cannot be treated with anger or in anger. We should come out of this mood and think constructively about what we should do, how we prevent this to happen again. And my last word is, all of us are united against this act, this horrible act, and we are together one Egyptian family at last.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for your fruitful input. I'd like to thank you, the viewers, and definitely what this didn't break us.
No.
It only made us stronger, and it made the Egyptians more adamant and more vicious about fighting terrorism. And on that note, I wish you a very pleasant evening. We'll see you same time next week. Until then, good night.